Welcome to iLecture Online. Now let's answer the question, why would a particle take the path of least action? So let's take a look again at our situation. Let's say that the particle is under the influence of a gravitational force and travels from one point to another point. We have the initial time, we have the final time, and the path taken will take the difference in amount of time. The time taken will be t final minus t initial. And that should be the same for every path that the particle would take. So we're going to assume that the black line truly represents the path the particle will take, and therefore we know that it's the path of least action. In other words, the average kinetic energy minus the average potential energy along the path will be a minimum. Also notice that initially the particle will have some initial kinetic energy and some initial potential energy. At the end, it'll have a final kinetic energy and a final potential energy. Typically, kinetic energy will be converted to potential energy, or potential energy will be converted to kinetic energy, depending upon what the particle is doing. But we can be assured that if no work is put into the system and no energy is lost due to friction or anything like that, that the initial total energy, which will be the sum of the kinetic plus the potential energy, will equal the final total of the energy, the sum of the final kinetic plus potential energy. We can go back to a very familiar equation where the initial potential energy plus the initial kinetic energy plus any work put into the system will equal to the final potential energy plus the final kinetic energy plus what energy might have been lost due to friction or resistance. Now, if both the amount of work put into the system and the energy lost by the system is zero, then again we see that the total initial energy must equal the total final energy. And the path taken by the particle will ensure that that's the case. So therefore, since the time from t final to t initial, or from t initial to t final, the difference between those two, must be the same for any path taken. Let's assume that the particle didn't follow this path, but a different path. Well, why would it want to take that different path? Remember that the least action means that the difference between the average kinetic energy and the average potential energy must be a minimum. So the red path represents any other path the particle may want to take for whatever reason. But notice, since the same amount of time is allotted for any path taken from this point to this point, and if the path then is a longer path, then you can see that because of the same time taken for the path, the velocity of that longer path must be greater. The average velocity along the other path will be greater, and therefore the total or the average kinetic energy along that new path will be greater. And if the average kinetic energy is greater, then the difference between them will be larger and will no longer be a minimum. The path taken will be such that the difference between these two is a minimum, and the key to solving the concept of the principle of least action is to find that path that represents the least action. How do we do that? Well, it'll take us a little while to get there, but at least we need to get the concept. So the concept is such that W, the amount of work put into the system, and the energy lost will be zero, so that the total initial energy will be the total final energy, and therefore the average kinetic energy minus the average potential energy will be a minimum for the path taken by the particle. We just need to figure out what that path is. And so that will then be the path of least action. So stay tuned and we'll slowly unravel this whole mystery for us so we can understand what we mean by the principle of least action. And that is how it's done.